other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Gosh. Gosh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
God. We bless your name.
Hallelujah.
We exalt you in this place. You are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Be exalted, Lord God. Be exalted in our hearts and in our lives as we surrender to you this morning. As we lift up the name of Jesus, may you be glorified in our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name. Well, isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. Hallelujah. I pray that God is doing something good in your life. Take some time, go around, greet one another, welcome somebody that you may not know. If you don't know somebody, welcome them this morning, even if they've been here for a year.
That's it, I guess.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea. Colors of fall to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique in the song that it sings. All exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God.
Your seats this morning. I'm going to ask our ushers if they would prepare to receive our offering this morning. I pray that the excitement that is in this place will be in your hearts and homes over the next couple of days as we celebrate the birth of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Someone shared with me this past week about something that God had done in their heart and in their life. And it was several weeks ago when we had evangelist Michael Rowan in, him and his wife, and they had been in the service on Sunday evening. And they came up to me a couple weeks ago and said, "Pastor, I just want to let you know that when evangelist Michael was here, that I gave my heart to the Lord." And I said, "Man, that is so exciting." And they said, "And you know what? It's amazing. My circumstances haven't changed, but I have peace in the midst of my circumstances." And I asked, I said, "Man, can you share that?" And they're like, "No, I'm too shy." I said, "Well, do you mind if I share?" And they're like, "Oh, please, please just share that." And they went on to say, "You know what? I've never attended church regularly. I've never really just sought after God. But the night when he spoke about the Titanic going down, all I could see was my life just going down, down. And I realized I needed somebody to rescue me." And I just rejoiced, because that's why we do church, folks. It's not for any other reason than to see people come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, whether that's here or across the globe through missions. But it's why we participate. It's why we celebrate. It's why we give in our tithes and our offerings, so that we can continue the work that God has poured out. And so this morning, as we give of our regular tithes and offerings, we just want to rejoice that the work that we are doing, it's changing lives. It's impacting lives. And that's why we give out of our tithes, out of our offerings. We'll be receiving a special offering a little bit later for our guests that are with us, but this is our regular tithe and offering. If you're visiting with us today, please don't feel obligated to give. This is for our regular attenders each and every week, as we just give to further the kingdom and what Christ is doing. Father, we thank you this day for who you are. Lord, we give you the praise that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we celebrate that this life has come and has just given over to you. And Lord, we rejoice that there are many today that will enter into the kingdom of heaven because of our faithfulness. And one day we will rejoice together, because God, you're calling us home. And until that day, may we be found faithful to serve you, love you, and to give as you have called us to give. And so we rejoice this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Kira has our offertory. Lovely.
Exciting when God is working in hearts and lives, and just be able to share and hear the testimonies of what God has done. And I'm going to ask Linda Elder if she'd come and just join me here. And Linda just wants to share this morning about something that God has done in her life, in her heart. And I can't think of a better time than at Christmas time, because this is why Jesus came, to help us, to change us, and to get us to focus on the power that he has to change our hearts and lives. Linda.
Thank you, Pastor. Last Sunday at our Life Connection group, it's a good light. Last Sunday at our Life Connection group, I shared with our group how I struggle with depression, and it's clinical depression. And I mask it pretty well, as you all know, but it's something that I struggle with daily. And mostly it's the inner voices that tell me lies that I entertain. And my healing in my spirit came like a flood a couple of days ago. But it started last Sunday with Pastor's message about how we obsess over what people think. And we should obsess over what God thinks. And so Pastor Wayne was a huge blessing in my healing. Another person that I'd like to bring up here is Greg. If you could come up here, Greg. Yes, you. No, not Greg Shannon. Greg, too. Greg, I shared with Greg my depression, and he said to me, he said, you need to go to your prayer closet and ask God to help you because you can't do this. And I said, well, as much as I pray, I've really never done that. You know, just really got on my knees and gone to my prayer closet, just me and God. And then he said something else that was very powerful. He said, is there anyone in your life that you love and look up to who has hurt you? And I really had to think about that, because men in my life, I don't respect men. Throughout my life, I've never found one that I respected. And that played a huge part in my depression and my road to this depression. So I thought about that, and it was my dad. And then Sunday at Life Connection, Jim, you have to come up here quickly. At Life Connection, I shared my depression, and Jim Rhodes said, maybe it's unforgiveness in your life. And I thought, well, I forgive everybody. That's my nature. I just forgive and move on. But then I thought about it, oh my goodness. That's what's keeping me in bondage, and you don't know it. You don't realize it. You think, oh, I forgave them, but you didn't, because your spirit says you didn't. And then he said, Jim said, and then he prayed for me. And then he said, I'm going to pray for Linda as God leads me during the week. And I'm thinking that's what he did. Because there was a huge, huge breakthrough. And then, and I said in Life Connection, I said, I don't want to forgive forcefully. I want to forgive genuinely. And I want it to be in my spirit to be more like Jesus. I want that peace and that genuine, not caring what people think, only caring what God thinks, but a genuineness. And then my husband, my sweet George. Come here, sweetie. Now, George, George has loved me through it, and he responded very well to my renewed spirit, if you will. And but if you will all notice, these are all men. And the tip of the icing on the cake that God gave me was a dream last night about my dad. My dad's passed, and in the dream, I was loving on him. I hugged him, and it was such a genuine, loving, spiritual, beyond me hug and love that I had for my dad. And I didn't make that connection until 10 minutes ago. So thank you, Lord, for the men in my life, and thank you for my renewed spirit. Thank you for lifting this depression and giving me freedom. Thank you.
Isn't God amazing? I mean, you can't write that. Only God can pen that kind of work. That's our awesome, awesome God. Hallelujah. Just want to make you aware of a couple announcements this morning. If you're visiting with us this morning, if this is your first time here or you're just kind of new to the church, we encourage you to take the time to fill out one of the communication cards in the chair in front of you. You can leave it on the chair or place it in the offering when it goes by, or we encourage you to stop by the information booth on the way out. We have a gift that we would love to share with you just to say thank you for being with us this morning. Tomorrow evening at 6:30, those of you that are part of the tax preparers ministry, you'll be meeting here at 6:30 with Scott Seifer, and we want to make sure that you are here. So getting ready to prepare taxes. This is such a blessing, such a ministry to our church family to be able to have your taxes prepared for free. And it's just a great opportunity to be a part of that ministry. Coming up, not this week, but next week is New Year's. And as we do every year, the Life group of the Rhodeses is going to be just putting together. Basically, they just open the door and tell you all to show up, bring food, bring games. And from 6 o'clock until just shortly after midnight, we just have a great time of fellowship, food, playing all kinds of different games. And then we bring in the New Year just by praying in the new year and believing that God is going to do great and mighty things in 2015. You don't have to sign up for that. Just show up anytime between 6 o'clock and midnight for a great time that will be on New Year's Eve. And finally, the Amazon Smile. Those of you that purchase gifts, go buy Amazon Smile. And on Amazon Smile, if you just type in New Life Assembly of God Altoona, it'll bring up the link where you can just purchase items through that. And 5% of your purchase will come back to the children's and youth ministry here at the church. Let me just say thank you from the bottom of my heart for those of you that gave last week in our Christmas blessing offering. We were able to help 24 different individuals or families with the funds that came in just to be a blessing to them over this holiday season. And we rejoice that in our faithfulness, God is able to touch hearts and touch lives beyond what we can even begin to imagine. So thank you for your faithfulness and for your giving in that. Amen. Well, it is a blessing to have with me with us this morning. The Van Briggles, Joel and Gail, and their children are with us, and they opened the service for us singing that beautiful song, and I just like to welcome them as they come. They're just going to share with us briefly about what God is calling them to do, and they're going to minister in song this morning. Would you welcome the Van Briggles this morning?
Well, good morning. God bless you. It is a pleasure to be here. We are the Van Briggles, and I am Joel.
Good morning. My name is Gail, and it's been a delight to get to worship with you this morning and to celebrate the birth of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who came to make a difference in all of our lives and in lives around the world. We wanted to introduce our children to you this morning. This is Anthony, and he is 11. And when we first shared with him that God was calling our family to move to Europe to serve him, Anthony's first question to us was, does that mean I have to sell all of my Legos? It's an important question, isn't it? And we found a way for him to be able to use his Legos to communicate the need of Christ in Europe. And Anthony, if you'll show us what you have in your hand there, you'll see he's got a Lego structure here. You'll see most of the Legos here are gray and just a few of them are red. On our table out here in the hallway, he's built a much larger bridge or castle structure. And we invite you to check that structure out, and you'll see it's the same pattern of gray and red bricks. And Anthony, can you share briefly with us what those red Legos are?
The red Legos are 3%, which is the amount of people who have a relationship with Christ in Europe.
It's a staggering number. And so we invite you to come by the table to see what 3% looks like. And while you're there, you can pick up one of our prayer cards. We'd love for you to take one of these home with you and to remember to pray for us. Now, Emily, we took a little bit of a different approach with Emily. She's 8, and her favorite food in the whole entire world is
chocolate.
And we are blessed that God is calling our family to live as we work in Europe. We'll be doing ministry in Eastern Europe, but God's called us to live in Brussels, Belgium. Yeah, and if you know anything about Belgium, you know they have great
chocolate.
Yes. And so at the table later this morning, when you come by to see that Lego structure and pick up a prayer card, Emily will be there, and if you would like, you can take a guess as to how many Legos are in that structure. And whoever comes closest to the amount of Legos in that structure is going to win
a Belgian chocolate bar
for you to take home with you. Thanks, Anthony and Emily, for being here with us today. We have a brief video to share with you with some important questions for all of us to consider.
God, every time I watch it, and I ponder the fact that about 500 years ago, the Protestant Reformation took place, when Christianity spread like wildfire all across Europe and spread to the rest of the world. Truly, Europe is the continent that brought God to the world. But as you fast forward just 500 years, Europe is now the continent that has forgotten God. It is very dark. There are more atheists and agnostics that are all spread throughout. And when communism ruled over Eastern Europe, and my wife and I have the privilege of overseeing the 22 countries of Eastern Europe, doing church planting and community revitalization, we have the privilege of planting churches. Friends, I want you to know that when new life is healthy, guess what? Your neighborhood is more healthy, your community. Altoona is better because you're here. And friends, when the body of Christ is functioning the way it's supposed to be, when you are bringing hope and light into a community, things begin to change. And so the team that we're joining in Brussels has planted over 41 churches since 2003. My first 8 months, as we continue to raise our budget here, we're hoping to get to Brussels in about at the end of January or beginning of February. Please pray about that. We just need that last part of our budget to come in. And I already know that my first 8 months, I have 4 churches that are ready to be launched. All we need to do is get there. And to realize that as we plant these churches, a lot of times humanitarian organizations will go in and do humanitarian work and then plant a church. We've turned that on its head because we believe that when you plant a church, it's through that church that you can meet the needs of the community. And so through these churches, we're touching lives and we're seeing lives and families transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to tell you, you can hand out water, you can hand out food all day long, you can even hand out gifts at Christmas time, but if you don't hand out Jesus Christ, real transformation doesn't take place. But when you give the hope of Jesus Christ, it changes everything. Friends, it changes depression. It changes lives. It changes those who are bound, those who are crushed by hopelessness. Now, friends, all of us are here because of a missionary. I don't know if you know that or not, but somewhere along the line, it may not have been this generation, it may have been last generation or the generation before that, but somewhere along the line, someone told somebody about Jesus, who told someone else about Jesus, who told someone else about Jesus, who told you about Jesus. Friends, you have received that which so many people, over 730 million people, yet to know the hope that Jesus gives. Now, friends, I am so thankful for what you're doing, and thank you for partnering with us. We are your hands and your feet extended to Eastern Europe. And I'm thankful for the gift that God has given me in you, because you are my hands and feet to Altoona. Because the truth is that we are all called. Look at the person next to you and say, you're called. Say it with gusto, friends. You're called. Friends, you are called to make disciples of all nations. I am called to make disciples in Altoona. But friends, I don't live in Altoona, do I? But God has given me you because you are my hands and feet. Spread to your coworkers, spread to the people that my heart beats for. I don't want to see one person in Altoona and the surrounding region not have an opportunity to hear about Jesus, and I'm thankful that you're here to do that. And in the same way, you're called to Romania, you're called to Slovakia, you're called to atheist Albania, you're called to all of those Eastern European countries that have been crushed by communism, and it is an honor. It is a privilege for me to be your hands and your feet extended to Eastern Europe. Isn't it cool how God works his work in the kingdom? That how we partner together and greater things are accomplished because we partner together. Amen? Amen. Well, when we go into villages, I've given you the big picture. Planting churches in over 22 different countries that have 19 different languages. My goal for my first 3 years is to learn a blessing, a greeting, and a joke in every single language. I don't know that I will accomplish it, but I will do my best. But I know that we're going to see lives transformed. And to give you the small picture, as we go into a village, I want to take you into a village this morning called Deaconess, Romania. And in Deaconess, it's a little gypsy village. It's a Roma village on the mountainside of Romania. Very remote. The gypsies are the most hated people in all of Europe. They were marginalized. They were outcasts. They're people that the government doesn't even want to admit exist. But how many know Jesus died for them? How many know that there's no one disposable? That every life matters? Amen? And so as we pondered this morning, we went into Deaconess. We met with the village leadership. There was a man there named Victor. And Victor is Victor right here and his family. Victor is really the community leader because he is the only adult in the community that can read or write. There are only three in the entire village that can read or write. We went to Victor and we said, Victor, how can we bless you? How can we partner with you? How can we know that God loves you. We love you. We want to bless you. And while he was skeptical at first, not knowing why in the world we had come to his village and why we were extending love to him in tangible ways, but he said, our houses are made of manure brick. They're not very strong. In fact, Deaconess Romania goes through winters just like we do here, yet without traditional heating or even airtight homes. They're very simple structures. He said, we really could use concrete to reinforce our home, and we really need a porch area. You see, in Deaconess Romania, it's kind of hard to believe in 2014, but there is no indoor running water. There is no indoor plumbing in these homes. And so he said, a porch area is a very important place for when you come from the fields, when you come from the bathroom, which is the wooded area next to the village, it's a place where you can clean up. He said, it's a very important place for us. We began, and we had a team of three van loads of New Jerseyans. Now let me tell you, three van loads of New Jerseyans anywhere is a good story. In Romania, it takes it to another level. But they had a heart for Jesus, and that's what I love, is as we began to pour concrete, we had 4 days to get to 24 homes, and we began to pour concrete. And as we began to pour concrete, at the end of each day, in our concrete clothes, we began to share with the community as they would gather around what the real foundation of life is all about. We began to give them Jesus. We began to share with them the gospel of Jesus Christ for the very first time and how he loved them and how he had a plan for their lives. And as we began to pour concrete, we saw the third day rain clouds began to roll in. Now, if you've ever laid concrete, how many know that rain and concrete, while they do mix, they don't mix well? And Elijah, it says in James chapter 5, was a man just like we are. He prayed and it didn't rain. And I remember standing on that hillside seeing those big rain clouds rolling in. And I said, Lord, if you could hold off the rain, it would be really, really helpful right now. And you know, not one drop of rain fell throughout the whole time. Not only did we do all 24 homes, and we also put an education wing, which is really just a one room on the back of the church. We laid a footer so that we could put an education room where the kids would have access to education to learn how to read and write for the very first time in this community. Let me tell you, that's a huge component to breaking the cycle of poverty. And how awesome is it that it's happening right at the local church? So as we left the mountainside, we had the last day we had Pastor George, the local pastor there, that's pastoring the church. We had him share the gospel one last time with the community. We saw people's lives transformed and changed even that very night. As we went off the mountainside, if you've ever been on a missions trip, you'll know dinner came at about 9:30 or 10 o'clock at night. You just never know when you're going to eat. But when we sat down to dinner, we didn't even realize that we were so exhausted and emotionally spent from all and sort of this exhaustion next to this extreme excitement about what God had done throughout the week. Well, during that time, as we had come out from dinner, the heavens had completely opened up. And we had looked to the two hillsides away into the village of Deaconess where we had worked. And there was lightning that was flashing and thunder that was rolling. And it was a tremendous storm and just rain coming down. And we wondered what had become of our concrete that day. The next morning, as we were packing up our tools, as we were gathering our supplies, as we were about to leave the country, Victor somehow had gotten over the two hillsides out to where we were staying. And he came and he said through his interpreter, he said, "You won't believe it. You won't believe it. The entire village is rejoicing. It's the first time we've woken up after a storm like this, and our houses aren't filled with mud." Now I want to tell you, it's a small component, but it's so strategic in understanding that as we partner with Deaconess, it's not for one concrete lay and be gone. We partner with every one of the communities in Eastern Europe for 3 to 6 years to be able to see long-term sustained growth, to see that church begin to thrive, and to be able to see the community be able to thrive. And in that village, we've seen just several weeks ago, it's been about 5 weeks ago now, they got water into the village for the very first time. We had a team from New York dig over 3 football fields to be able to bring a water line up to the village for the very first time. There's a church that meets there every Sunday and every Wednesday. People are being discipled and lives are being changed. And we have the privilege of doing this all over Eastern Europe. Thank you for praying for us. Pray that we get to the field quickly. Understand that we're working in our 40th country in 2015 with a team of 6. We need people who are called into missions. So pray that God would send forth more laborers into the field. Pray that God will help us get to the field quickly. And pray that those who don't have hope will receive hope. We want to share one last song with you as we just share this Christmas season and recognize what God has done for us.
Divine. Oh, joyful we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, hail thee as the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. God of glory, Lord of love.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you so much. I'm going to ask our ushers if they would prepare to receive offering. We want to give a love offering to the Van Briggles, and just to say that we love and care about you, and greater than that, that we want to partner together in spreading the good news of Jesus Christ to Eastern Europe. A couple weeks ago, we had a board meeting, and before the Van Briggles were even here, together as a board and pastoral staff, we decided that for 2015, that we were going to pick up the Van Briggles for our monthly support, and we're going to add them to part of our missions, and we just rejoice in what God is going to do. And we're just so glad you didn't disappoint us this morning so that we could say, yes, we're able to do that. But no, it is a blessing. And so, Father, this morning, as we give in this offering, Lord, I pray that you would bless both the gift and the giver. Lord, as the good news of Jesus Christ is spread in tangible ways in the Eastern Europe, Lord, I pray that one day as we stand before you in heaven, that you would look at us and say, well done, good and faithful servants. And Father, that we will have other people say, thank you for giving. Because of your faithfulness in giving, I am here. I am able to stand beside you in heaven. And Lord, we pray that you would bless the Van Briggles. Lord, that you would equip them financially, physically, emotionally, spiritually, to just be able to get over there as soon as possible. Lord, as they look at the end of January, early February, Lord, that you would just make that happen. And Lord, we just can't wait to hear even greater reports of what you are doing as we partner together in Jesus' name. Amen. Speaking of partnering together, Gail and Miss Harchek have partnered together for our offertory. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Kelly and Gail. What a wonderful blessing that is. Amen. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm excited about what God is doing. And this past week, we had a little bit of extra time here at the church, and so I got Pastor Micah together and Pastor Kevin, and we decided that we wanted to do something special for the congregation this morning. So if you please just turn your attention to the video screen. We've taken time this week just to do this just for you.
Get up.
That is exactly how it went down, let me tell you. If you're ever here, I'm always the one on the top of the ladder, and then I'm always the one that's usually laying on the floor. But we're just so thankful to be able to be a part of this wonderful church. And so from my heart and from Pastor Kevin and Pastor Micah and even Pastor Woody now, we are just happy to say Merry Christmas to each of you. And we pray that God will truly bless your Christmas season and that the trueness of why he came would just really be birthed in your heart and in your lives. So Merry Christmas from all of us, the pastoral staff here at New Life. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, if you would take them, please, and turn to the book of Luke, Luke chapter 2. I just want to share with you briefly this morning. Last week we looked at a message that was given to Joseph. And we talked about how Joseph was in a situation where the woman he was to be married to all of a sudden became pregnant. And yet he had not been with her. And she came to him and said, Joseph, I don't know how to tell you this, but I'm pregnant. And not only am I pregnant, but I'm pregnant by the Holy Spirit. We talked about how crazy that must have sounded to Joseph and how Joseph had considered in his heart to divorce her quietly. Until an angel appeared to Joseph and said, Joseph, fear not. Don't be afraid. Because your wife-to-be, she really is pregnant with the Son of God. And his name will be called Jesus. He'll be the Messiah. Emmanuel, God with us. We talked about the different fears that Joseph must have been going through. The fears of what people would have thought about him. And the situation that he was placed in, and how important it is for us not to look at what other people think about us and to be focused so much on what people think about us. And I love the testimony that Linda shared this morning, because it's about not focusing on what others think, but about what God thinks. And we saw in that story that God was in control, that God was working in the heart and the life of Joseph. And this morning I want us to take a look, and we're going to take a look a little bit further on in the story of the birth of Christ. And as we come to this part of the story, we find that it's a very familiar part to us. We all look at the nativity scene, and if you have a nativity set that you put out, you know, you have little baby Jesus in the manger, you have Mary and Joseph, and you have, you know, the angel. You have some donkey, a camel, maybe a little sheep there. You have the wise men that show up with their gifts.
But no nativity scene is complete without a couple of shepherds. And it's these shepherds that I want us to look at this morning, because as we find in this Christmas story, the shepherds are a group of people that nobody really even wanted to associate with. They were a group of people that were just kind of out on a hillside. They were the forgotten people. And yet, they are probably one of the most important group of people in all of the Christmas story. And when we take a look at the life of the shepherds, we find that a question is asked. A question that they were probably asking themselves over and over and over again. As a shepherd, where do I stand with God? As a shepherd out on the hillside, what is my relationship with God? What is my standing with God? What will happen to me when I die? We can ask those questions of ourselves. What is my life standing with God? Where do I line up with Him in today's culture, in today's society? Have I been good enough? Have I done enough to earn the respect of God, to get myself into heaven someday? How is it possible for us to measure where we stand with God? Are we good enough? How do we compare with others? Where is my standing? Growing up as a child, I'll never forget this. And I even kind of did this with my own kids, but changed it up a little bit. But growing up, whenever we would go to bed, my parents would come into the room and they'd say, "Okay, Wayne, it's time to go to bed. Let's say our prayers." And we'd kneel beside the bed and we'd start to pray this prayer. "Now I lay me down to sleep." And I'm thinking, okay, yeah, that's a good prayer. "Now I lay me down to sleep." I'm going to sleep. I don't want to go to sleep, but my mom and dad say I have to go to sleep, so I'm going to sleep. "Now I lay me down to sleep." And then all of a sudden, it took this crazy twist. "I pray the Lord my soul to keep." I'm thinking, whoa, hold on a second. What's a soul? Why do I want God to keep my soul? "I pray the Lord my soul to keep." Not too bad. But then it takes this really freaky, crazy turn. Now, mind you, we teach this to our 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 year old kids. "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake." Wait a second. If I should die before I wake, is some axe murderer going to jump into my bed tonight and just say, "That's it, Wayne, you're done"? If I should die before I wake, do I have to look under the bed and see, is that crazy clown under there? What's going on? And then it says, "If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." Oh, I don't know about this prayer. God's going to take my soul if I die? And I can remember just saying, okay, I'm praying this prayer. "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die," I don't want to die. "God, please don't let me die tonight. If I should die before I awake, I pray the Lord, God, I pray that you take my soul, because God, I really don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven." Amen. And then my mom or dad would tuck me into bed. And I can remember they walk out of the room, turn off the light. First thing I do, I'll be checking under the bed. Is that crazy clown under there? What's going to happen? I go to the closet. Is the axe murderer in there? I pull the blinds. I make sure, okay, nobody's here. But then I'd get back in bed and I'd lay there and I'd just think, okay, God, if I die, if for some reason that crazy man shows up tonight and I die, God, I'm sorry I picked on my sister today. God, please forgive me. God, I'm sorry I lied to my mom today. I was the one that took the cookie. It wasn't my sister. God, please forgive me. I don't want to die. And if I die, I want you to have my soul, because I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. Oh, God, I'm sorry. Would you forgive me for picking on that girl at school with ponytails? I didn't mean to pull on that hard. God, forgive me today. I don't want to die, God. But if I do, I want to make sure that I get to heaven. God, I know I did this wrong. I did that wrong. And this was the routine almost every night of my life as a little child, just saying, God, I don't want to die, but if I do, I want to make sure that everything is right with you. I want to make sure that I measure up to where I think I'm good enough that you'll say, okay, I'll take your soul to heaven instead of sending it to hell. And as a child, we can think these ways, we think these things, and if we don't get the right understanding of what Christ did for us, it can lead into adulthood as well, and we get this idea of, I have to measure up. I have to be good enough. I have to do this. I have to do that. I have to build myself up and make myself good enough so that if I die by chance, God will look down and say, okay, you've done good enough. I'll let you into heaven. Or we look around the room and we start to compare ourselves with other people. And we say, well, I'm better than them, so certainly God will let me into heaven. I know that they're worse off than I am, so I'm sure that God's going to let me in. And yet we confess every little fear about what it is that we're going through. Today, as we look at this fear not story, it is probably one of the best known stories of the Christmas season. And for all of us here this morning, I want you to hear this message of fear not, and I want it to be a life-changing message for you, because it is only when we understand why Christ came, it is only when we understand who Christ came for and who Christ came to, that we recognize that there truly is nothing that we have to fear, because God is with us. Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. If you have your Bibles, turn there. If not, it'll be on the screen. Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. It says, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, and they were keeping watch over their flocks by night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified." Once again, here's Joseph last week. Joseph is just going through the routine, and all of a sudden this angel appears to him, and he's going, "Whoa, what's going on? This isn't right. Something's happening here." And the angel says, "Fear not." Here we find the shepherds. They're out on the hillside taking care of business, doing their same old thing, day in, day out, taking care of the sheep out on the hillside. "Come on, sheep, get over here. Get over there. Stay away from that. Stay away from this." Just keeping watch over the sheep. When all of a sudden, out of nowhere, appears this mighty angel in the sky. Kind of like if we were to be out on the back porch in the middle of the summer, just looking up, and all of a sudden, boom, this giant light shines out. What would we think? We'd be afraid. We'd be a little scared. What's going on? And the angel says, "Fear not. Don't be afraid." And I love what it says next. "I bring you good news." For most of us, just the sight of the angel would shock us into fear. And then all of a sudden, this angel says, "Don't worry, fear not, I bring you good news." Now, if an angel shows up, usually you're thinking, okay, this isn't a good situation. But here the shepherds are, they see this angel, and the angel says, "I bring you good news." But not only good news that will cause great joy for all people. I'm bringing you some good news, and it's not only good news to you, but it will be good news to all people. It will bring great joy to everyone. Verse 11, "Today in the town of David," here's the good news, "a Savior has been born to you." I bring you good news. It's going to bring great joy to everyone that receives, to everyone that believes. "Today, a Savior has been born in the town of Bethlehem. He is the Messiah. He is the Lord. Today, I bring you good news. Fear not, church. A Savior has been born. Today, I bring you good news. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to worry, because Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah, the Savior of the world, he has been born." And friends, let me tell you, that is the best news that any of us could ever receive. Jesus has been born. Why is it good news? People are sitting there going, "Well, what do I need saved from? What do I need a Savior for? I think I'm doing pretty good on my own. I don't need a Savior to come into my life." Back in the day of Mary and Joseph, they would typically hire somebody called a herald. Whenever a child was born, they would pay some money, and the herald would go and he would announce the birth of this child. Usually a herald would go and announce the birth to somebody prominent. They would go and announce it to a king, to a priest, to a prophet, to a Sadducee. They would go in and they would announce the birth of this child because they wanted everybody to know that this child had been born. Mary and Joseph, they couldn't even afford a room at the inn. How are they going to afford to announce the birth of their son, Jesus? But you see, God the Father had it all under control. God said, "You know what? I'm gonna announce the birth of my son, and I'm gonna do it in kind of a different way. I'm not gonna announce it to the king, to the priest. I'm not gonna announce it to the scribes and the Pharisees. I'm gonna announce it to the lowliest of the low. I'm gonna announce it to those that don't even think that they are worthy to know who I am." And the Bible says that he sent an angel. We sing that song, "Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn king." He sent his own heralds. He sent him out on the mountaintop to announce the birth of his son, not to a king, not to a priest. No, he sent his angel to announce his birth to a bunch of shepherds. A bunch of shepherds. You see, the nativity scene isn't complete without having the shepherds there, because they were the first ones to hear that Jesus Christ had been born. They were the first ones to receive the good news, the message that Christ had come. Who are these shepherds? Well, if you take a look and you study the life of a shepherd back in this day, you'll find that the shepherd was the lowest ranking and probably the most embarrassing job that anyone could have. The shepherd represented usually the youngest of the sons. They would be given that position. When we've been looking at the life of David, we see that David, as the youngest son, was sent out to deal with the sheep. The older sons had other important jobs, but David was found to be with the sheep. Isn't it amazing that out of the line of David would come Jesus? Out of the line of a shepherd would come the Son of God? And that the first people that God would announce that he sent his son to would be the shepherds, the lowliest of low, the ones that nobody looked upon? If they weren't the youngest sons, they were either considered slaves or those that had done something wrong. A shepherd would have been somebody that was uneducated. They had no career, no hope for an advancement in their career. Once a shepherd, always a shepherd. When they look at the shepherds in the religious culture, they were known as failures or even outcasts. They were actually told that they were not good enough for God. God doesn't want to have anything to do with you, shepherds. No matter how hard they tried, they could not measure up. And they were in constant fear of what God thought about them, constant fear of whether or not they could even make it to heaven. But why did they feel this way? Why did the shepherds feel this way? Let me give you three reasons this morning. I think that the shepherds may have felt that they didn't measure up, that they weren't good enough for God. Three reasons the shepherds felt that they were distant from receiving the blessing of the Lord. Number one, the shepherds probably felt that they were unworthy. They were unworthy. And as we look at the life of these shepherds and we talk about these attributes that they may have felt, I want you to ask yourself if you fit into that same category when it comes to God. The shepherds looked and said, I don't feel worthy enough. As I mentioned, they were the outcasts in Israel. They were taught that they weren't good enough for God, that they weren't good enough for religion. The very work that they did would make them ceremonially unclean. Because of being a shepherd, they were out 24/7, 7 days a week. They were out there all the time taking care of the sheep. They couldn't just say, well, I'm gonna leave my sheep and I'm going to go to church this week. I'm going to go to temple this week. No, they couldn't do that. They had to be with the sheep. And so therefore, they never made it to the temple. They never made it to make sacrifice. They never made it to do what the law had prescribed for them. Kind of like a trucker in our day-to-day. A trucker will be out on the road for 10 days and they might miss a Sunday or two or three or four. They may miss a whole lot of opportunity to make it to church. And so they felt, man, we can't even make it into the temple, so we're unworthy. We're not worthy to stand before God. Not only that, but they hung around sheep all day. Have you ever hung around sheep all day? They're not the best smelling things in the world. Oh, they may be fun and cuddly and cute to look at. Oh, look at the sheep. Aren't they cute? Yeah, go hang out with them all day. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. These shepherds, they didn't have an opportunity to run down to the creek and bathe themselves. They would hope that one of their sheep would run away and jump in a creek just so they could get a bath themselves. That's how bad a shepherd had it. They were always with the sheep. And so not only did they not make it into the temple to worship God, but they were physically unclean as well. If they would walk by, people would look at them and they would say, unclean, unclean, because they had not been able to cleanse themselves. And so when they looked around, they said, man, I don't feel worthy. I don't measure up. That's how many of us are today. We know what we've done is wrong. We know that we should have done this or we should have done that. And we look and we say, man, I am not worthy of what God has given. I am not worthy of measuring up to God's standards. You come to church and you look and everybody looks so good. Everybody's worshiping God. And, you know, on your way here, all you wanted to do was kill your kids in the back seat. You know, you're saying, oh, I wish my arm was longer. I can't reach. And then all of a sudden you pull the greatest trick of every dad in the book. You hit the brake and the kids come flying forward. Dad, gotcha. Hallelujah. Stop that. Stop fighting back there. Don't you see that invisible line? You stay over that. And you're fighting and you're arguing and you're looking in the mirror and you say, honey, can't you get your daughter to just brush her hair on the way to church this morning? Can't you take care of that? What is going on? And you pull into the church parking lot. As you're pulling, you're going, oh, I kind of just blew it on my way to church. Bless God, we're going to worship today. Hallelujah. You get out of the car and you try and put on the show. You try and put on the act. Hey, we got everything together. And yet as you're walking in, you're going, I don't feel worthy. I don't feel worthy. I'm not worthy. I don't measure up to everybody else. I don't have it all together. Kind of just like the shepherds. You messed up a little bit. You don't feel so unworthy. You don't feel unworthy. Number two, they didn't only feel unworthy, but they felt inadequate. The life of a shepherd was one of not being educated. As soon as they were old enough, they were sent out into the fields. They didn't receive the education like the oldest of the children. They didn't receive the education of the well-to-do. Uneducated, inadequate socially. So they really just never measured up in the social standards. That's always the case whenever you try to compare yourself to somebody else. Anytime you try and compare yourself with somebody else, you're always going to feel inadequate. Because somebody else can always do it a little bit better than you. Somebody else is always going to come to church looking just a little bit better than you. Somebody else is always going to drive up and sit in that car beside you, and you're going to go, man, I wish I had a ride like that. Somebody else is always going to have a bigger house than you. Somebody else is always going to have more money than you. Somebody else is always going to have that perfect situation that you just wish that you could have. And if you're always trying to measure up to somebody else, you will always, always feel inadequate. Ladies, you go over to one of your girlfriend's house, and as you're driving up the driveway, you can smell the cookies, you can smell the candle. As you open the front door, you look in, and man, it's so spotless, everything's in place, and you're thinking, man, I could eat off of this floor. Man, she's got it all together. Her children come in and says, Mom, what can I do for you today? How can I help you? How can I bless you, Mommy? I just really want, and you're sitting there going, man, that she's got it all worked out. Her kids love her. They take care of everything in the house, and you walk out the door. Or you get in your car and you go home. As you're driving up the driveway, you look out and go, man, there's toys all over the yard. You open the door and man, that smell just hits you. Man, who forgot to put their socks in the laundry? Man, it stinks in this house. And you walk in and you're looking, and you're going, man, I don't even know if I can eat off my floor because I can't even see my floor. There's stuff all over the place. And you start comparing yourself to that other person. And all of a sudden you realize, man, I'm not good enough. I don't measure up to them. I don't measure up. You're that husband, you're that father, and you look and say, man, I don't make quite as much as they do. I'm not good enough. You look and you say, I don't measure up. I'm inadequate. You will always, always, always be able to find somebody that you look inferior to. And as long as you're focused on what everybody else is and who everybody else is, you will never feel that you measure up. Never. See, not only did the shepherds think physically they were inadequate, but also spiritually inadequate. They couldn't keep the Sabbath. The sheep needed protection 24/7. Sometimes we do the exact same thing. Some people seem so close to God. You're sitting in the service this morning, you're looking around saying, man, I wish I was just like them. They just seem so close to God. They seem like they got everything together. I know if I ask them, they've got the Bible memorized. I know they could quote all the books of the Bible right in a row. I could ask them a scripture verse and they could tell me exactly where it's found. Man, they've got it all together. Me, not so much. I didn't even realize there wasn't a book called Second Hesitations. I didn't know that wasn't even in the Bible. How many books? Six. I didn't even know there were 66 books in the Bible. But they do. I know that they've got it all together. Man, they pray such powerful prayers. Their prayers are, man, I love listening to them pray. I love this. Because, man, I can tell they've got it all together. Man, all I want to do when I pray is, man, God, help me to survive the holidays with my in-laws. That's my biggest prayer this year. And we look around and we compare. Why am I not as spiritual as they are? Why am I not as spiritual? So the shepherds thought, man, I'm inadequate, I'm unworthy. And ultimately, number three, they felt unloved. Shepherds were pretty much known as thieves. Shepherds in the day weren't even allowed to testify in courts because nobody would believe them. Because they were just out to get whatever they could. Parents didn't want their daughters to marry a shepherd. I can just see it. Hey, Dad, I found the guy of my dreams. Oh, he's so charming. He's so handsome. Well, who is it? Well, it's that shepherd. What? It's that shepherd boy. No. You're not hooking up with that shepherd boy. That's how low of a standard they were. Sadly, that's the way many people are feeling today. We're unloved. We don't feel like anybody loves us. Maybe we grew up without a dad. Maybe a spouse left us. Maybe we don't have great self-worth. We look into the mirror and we go, man, what's wrong with me? Nobody likes me. Nobody cares about me. Oh, woe is me. I can't carry on anymore because I don't think anybody loves me. I don't even love myself. How could God love me if I can't even love myself? What did I do wrong? And we start looking at ourselves and we start blaming ourselves for everything. And we start taking on that burden saying, it's me. People rejected me and I don't even like myself. How can God accept me? Friends, let me tell you, that's the difference between perception and reality. There's a huge difference in the way we perceive things and the true reality of them. How many of you have seen the movie Home Alone? Okay, Home Alone, and you know, you got the crazy old lady, the bird lady out in the park, okay? And everybody kind of stays away from her. And the first time little Home Alone dudes, Macaulay Culkin sees her, he's like, whoa, I'm getting away, and he runs away. And then he sees her again, and he's scared to see her. Perception. But the reality is she was one of the most loving, caring people. What we perceive isn't always the reality of the way things are. You're looking around today thinking, yeah, he's got it together. She's more successful than I am. I bet they didn't fight on their way to church like we did. Why am I so messed up? Why am I this way? Why am I that way? If they only knew. And yet you don't know what that person beside you is going through. You don't know what that person in front of you, behind you, you don't know what they've been facing in their life. Oh, they might look like they've got it all together today, but deep down inside, they might be going through some hurt. They might be going through some pain in their life. Just like you. You might be sitting next to somebody that looks incredibly successful, but inside they're carrying such a burden, such a pain. And they really don't feel like they have anyone close to them, somebody that they just can open up to. Where are they? Shepherds, unworthy, inadequate, unloved. And when you look at the life of a shepherd, they're expected to live up to the religious duties, the religious call of that day. And yet religion certainly did not work for the shepherds. And friends, I'm here to tell you this morning that religion will not work for us as well. There is a reason that God said, I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people, to you shepherds. I'm telling you first, it's going to bring great joy to you because no longer do you have to live up to the standard. No longer do you have to be religious. But I am giving you the opportunity to have a relationship with me. Religion didn't work for them and it doesn't work for us. God didn't send Jesus into the world to bring religion into the world, but in so many ways, he came to bring us hope, bring us life, to set us free from religion, to give us something better in life. You see, if you're focused on religion, you're focused on the externals. The problem with religion is that religion reduces Christianity down to just a bunch of rules, to a bunch of do's and a bunch of don'ts. If I do the right thing, if I feel better about myself, if I don't do the wrong thing, I'll feel better about myself. If I give more in the offering, everything will be good. If I give more at church, everything will be good. If I serve here, if I serve there, then everything will be okay. We limit it into a bunch of rules and regulations. I have to be a good person. Man, I'm a good person. I know I'm a good person. I don't do what they do. I'm a good person. I don't drink, I don't chew, and I don't go with girls that do. So hallelujah, God, I know I'm good because that person over there, I know what they do. And we try to measure ourselves up by saying, man, I don't do this, I don't do that. But if you do that, guess what? God is not pleased. You see, Jesus looked down on that kind of behavior and said, it makes me sick. He said to the Pharisees, he said, you're so focused on the outside that you're missing the whole aspect that the inside is a filthy mess. The outside looks so clean, but the inside is where it really matters. The inside is what is most important to God. It doesn't matter how messed up things are on the outside, because God can change the outside. God can do a work on the outside, but he has to start it from the inside. And you see, the Pharisees were so messed up on the inside, they didn't even recognize their need for help. Religion didn't work for the shepherds. It doesn't work for us because Christianity was never meant to be a religion. Christianity was never meant to be about a bunch of rules and regulations. Christianity was always meant to be about a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's why it's such good news. That's why it brings such joy to our life, because it's not about having to do this and having to do that and having to meet this standard and meet that standard. No, it's about the joy that Christ brings to our life because he's within us. And when you're in a healthy relationship, when you're a happy relationship, man, don't you have some joy that's there? That's what Christ came to bring. That's why God sent a person. That's why God sent Jesus, his son. That's the good news of this message. You may be here this morning. People are here today feeling unworthy, feeling inadequate, feeling unloved. Mom, let me tell you this morning, you can't do it all. You just can't. Dad, you may look at the checkbook and say, man, I don't know how we're going to afford Christmas this year. That's all right. Stop looking at yourself as a failure. Just think about the entire rest of the year that you're able to provide for your family. Stop looking and say, well, we don't have what our neighbors have. Start saying, man, I'm grateful for what God has blessed us with. Parent this morning, say, man, I don't know. My kids have gone here. My kids have gone there. I don't know what I did. Stop blaming yourself. And start praying for your kids. And just start believing from here on out that God's going to bring them around. Maybe you're going through some things in your life, some hurt, some difficulties. And you sit there go, I'm unworthy. I'm inadequate. I'm unloved. 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 Boom! Fear not! Can you imagine that? That's what it was. The shepherds are out on the hillside. Oh, yeah, here's a sheep. Oh, I'm unworthy. Man, what's going on in the city? And this bright light, and all of a sudden, fear not! I bring you good joy, good news of great joy. Hallelujah, some of you just woke up, praise God. And that's the good news. God sent his son to wake us up, to get our attention, to drive us away from religion and into a relationship. Let me boil it down, what this good news truly is. Maybe you never heard of the Apostle Paul, but Paul, before he was serving the Lord, he was actually a Christian hater. He hated the Christians. He would do whatever he could to drive them out of cities. He could do whatever he could to even have them put to death. He hated Christians. But the good news came. And the good news hit Paul right upside the head. He had an encounter just like the shepherds. And Paul decided, man, I'm going to follow after Jesus. Paul wrote most of the New Testament. In the New Testament, we find in Romans chapter 3, verses 20 through 22, what this good news is all about. I want to read it to you from the New Living Translation this morning. Listen to this. It says, "For no one can ever be made right with God by doing what the law commands. The law simply shows us how sinful we are. But now God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ." And I love this. It goes back to the very beginning. "And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who you are." I'm unworthy, I'm unloved, I'm inadequate. I'm unworthy, I'm unloved, I'm inadequate. No, you're not. If you simply believe, Jesus says, it is for you. No matter who you are, no matter what you think about yourself, no matter where you are in today's society, God looks up and looks down and says, oh, I love you. I've got good news. I'm sending my son to you. Let me give you just the three simplest ways that we can know this good news. Number one, you can't earn God's acceptance by observing the law. God isn't looking down and saying, oh yeah, Johnny's been very good today. I'll put him on the nice list. Oh, Beth, bad. So Sorry, Beth. I don't know why I said Beth. Beth has been very good today. Beth's on the good list. Suzanne. Oh, she's on the really good list today. Michael came home to visit Mom. Super good list. Joel didn't sing too bad today. We'll put him on the good list. Woody, he's still wearing that bow tie. Bad list. That's not God. God doesn't have a naughty or nice list. God has one book, and it's called the Book of Life. And the Book of Life puts the names of those that have accepted his son, Jesus Christ, as Lord and Savior. It doesn't say, okay, here's the book of those that accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. And here's the other book. Those that say they know Jesus, but well, they messed up this day, they messed up that day, they messed up this day. No, God has one book. And the book is, do you have your name in that book? You can't be good enough for God by trying to obey all the rules of the law. Listen to this. The Pharisees, they tried to observe 613 different laws. 613. Man, we can't even remember the first 10 that God gave us, let alone 613. How many of you this morning, if I had you come up onto this platform, you could quote all 10 commandments right in a row? Very few of us. And yet the Pharisees, they say, man, we have 613 laws. Look at us. We are better than you. Nobody can keep up with that. God started out with 10, but God broke it down in the New Testament to just two. Love God. Love people. Love God. Love people. For no one can ever be made right with God. Verse 20 says, by doing what the law commands. No one can be made right with God by doing what the law commands. You can't measure up to the standard of 613 laws of the Pharisees. Oh, but God said, love me, love others. How simple is that? Well, for some of us, it's pretty hard because we have to have a relationship with him. Number two, the purpose of the law is not to show you your need, or the purpose of the law is to show us our need for a Savior. Verse 20 says, no one can be made right with God by doing what the law commands. The law simply shows us how sinful we are. Think about it. What's the law do? It reveals our need for a Savior. So the most important things that I want you to understand this morning, one of the biggest flaws in our thinking today is that we actually think that we are good. When we compare ourselves to others, we actually think, well, I am pretty good compared to that person. I'm pretty good. God's going to look at me and say, man, yep, you're doing good. You're better than they are. I mean, be honest. How many of you basically think you're a good person this morning? Come on, it's okay. Put your hand up. You think you're a good person. Some of you, you need to work on that a little bit. I want you to be a good person. But we think we're good. In a sense, we think we've got things a little bit better than the person next to us. And it's easy to think we're good when we compare. It's Christmas time and Santa has his naughty and nice lists, but I want us to do a little exercise this morning, something that will make you feel really good about how really bad you are. Does that sound good? All right, so I want us all to be honest this morning. Everybody's got to participate. So it's Christmas time, and you don't want a lump of coal that I'm going to give if you don't participate. So everybody needs to participate. All right, how many of you here this morning have ever told a lie? You've told a lie. Look around. Look around. If they don't have their hand up, they're lying. They're lying. Okay? We've told a lie. All right. You can put your hand down. Okay, you've told a lie. What does that make you? A liar. Okay, we've all lied, so we're nothing but a bunch of liars. All right, how many of you, be honest, you've ever stolen anything in your life? Be honest, you ever stole anything? You stole a cookie from the cookie jar. Last Sunday, you stole a church pen and went home with it. See? All right. See, we've all stolen. Okay, if you've stolen something, what does that make you? No, it doesn't make you a stealer, okay? I heard somebody say that. Okay, it makes you a thief, okay? So you're a liar, you're a thief. Okay, this next one, I don't want to get anybody in trouble. So kind of put your arms like this, okay? And if this is you, just kind of wave a pinky at me, okay? You don't have to put your hand up, you know, just pinky, okay? Just like that, all right? How many of you this morning in your lifetime you've ever looked at somebody lustfully? Be honest. Yeah. Why are you back there going like this? Okay. All right, so if you've lusted after somebody in your heart, what's the Bible say you are? Fornicate, an adulterer. Okay. You looked at somebody, lusted after somebody. Okay, so this morning, hallelujah, praise God, we are a church filled of liars, stealers, and adulterers. Don't you feel good about yourself this morning? Isn't that great? New Life is filled with liars, thieves, and adulterers. Man, you look so good. Did you know that your pastor is a liar, a thief, and an adulterer? Yeah, Pastor Micah, I can say whatever I want about him. No, see, I can't because I'm right there with him. I'm right there with all of you. We've all told a lie. We've all stolen. We've all had thoughts that we shouldn't have had. So basically, we're a church full of people that really are unworthy. We're a church full of people that are unloved, that feel inadequate. But you see, when you recognize that you are not a good person compared to God's standards, when you recognize, man, you're not as good as you really think you are, that it's then that you recognize, I need a Savior. I need a Savior. I don't need a bunch of more rules to keep me in line. I need a relationship with somebody that's going to straighten me out, that's going to walk with me and talk with me. When we recognize we're a sinner, then we won't be looking for salvation in religion, but we'll be looking through it, looking for it in a person. 2,000 years ago, a Savior was born. Christianity was never meant to be a religion, but a relationship with a loving God. God sent his Son to reveal just how good he is. So what's the good news? The good news is you can't be good enough for God by observing the law. What's the purpose of the law? The purpose of the law is to show us our need for a Savior. So how are we made right with God? Finally, this morning, the only way we can be made right with God is that the good news teaches us righteousness with God comes by faith in Christ alone. Verse 22 says we are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who you are. Shepherds, behold, I bring you good news of great joy to all people. Paul says it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what your standing is in life. If you simply believe in Jesus Christ, you'll be saved. Church, it's not Christ plus religion equals heaven. It's not Christ plus church membership. It's not Christ plus giving money. It's not Christ plus good work. It's not Christ plus anything. It is simply Christ and Christ alone that we find our salvation, that we find our hope, that we find our healing, that we find heaven in Christ and in Christ alone. Stop trying to find it in relationship with others. Stop trying to find it in trying to do all these kind of good works. Shepherd said, fear not, I bring you good news. You unworthy, you inadequate, you unloved shepherds, fear not, for today a Savior has been born to you. Shepherds, to you. To you liars in the back row, to you thieves on this side, to all of you adulterers in the front, good news, God sent his Son. Good news. You can rejoice. You can celebrate because it's not about keeping the law anymore. It's about having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Christmas isn't about a religious experience. It's all about a relationship. Putting on the righteousness of Christ, not the righteousness of man. Are you good enough for God on your own? No, you're not. But because of what the Son did on the cross, he became sin for you. Dying in your place, raising to new life. Because of that, when you place your faith in him, God no longer sees your sin. I love this. God no longer sees your sin, but he sees the righteousness of Christ. He sees the righteousness of Christ. When he looks at you, he doesn't see that thief. He doesn't see that liar. He doesn't see that adulterer. He looks and he says, I see my Son. Because it's about a relationship, not religion. Religion is about what we do or don't do. Relationship is about what God did in his perfect work. Religion could be spelled D-O. That's how you spell religion, D-O. Do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. And if you do all that, you might be good enough. Relationship is called done. D-O-N-E. Christ paid it all. He paid it all. And all to him we owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but his blood has washed us white as snow. Church, it is completely done. Religion says I have to work hard. If I work harder, I may please God. Relationship says because I am already accepted with God by Christ, therefore I want to work hard. I want to work hard. Because I have a relationship, I want to work hard. I want to do what's right. I want to follow after him. It's not because I have to. It's because I want to. When you're in a loving relationship with a husband, a wife, a boyfriend, a girlfriend, and you love them and you love them, what do? You want to do good for them, don't you? You want to make them proud of you. And that's the same way it is with Christ. Because we're in a relationship with him, we want to please him. We want to make him happy. It's not because we have to. It's because we want to. So no matter how bad you've been, no matter how messed you up you are, how alone you feel, let me read this verse again, verse 22. We are made right with God. Not by good works, not by religion, but we are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for every single one of us who believe. Who believe. And the last part of that says, no matter who we are. No matter who you are. That's the good news, church. No matter who you are, a Savior has been born. His name is Christ, and he is the Lord's. A Savior has been born. Would you bow your heads this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, the good news that is bringing great joy is that the old has passed away. The law has been abolished. We don't have to live up to the 613 decrees that the Pharisees tried to keep, all the while on the inside, just being a mess. God, you went to the messiest of the messy on the outside, and you looked at their heart and said, man, those are the ones I want to give my message to. Those are the ones that I want to herald the good news that my son is being born. Maybe you're here this morning and your whole life you've just been comparing yourself with others. You've seen yourself in the eyes of the shepherd, unworthy, inadequate, and unloved. Maybe you even came in this morning feeling those same feelings. But as you've heard this message this morning, you recognize it doesn't matter. Because everybody else around me is just like me. And yet God sent his son. And there is good news. And I believe that good news this morning that he sent his son. I believe that good news that Jesus was born in the town of David, in the city of Bethlehem. I believe that when he was born, the angel appeared before the shepherd and said, fear not, I bring you good news of great joy. And today I want to be like those shepherds. Who for probably one of the first times in their life, they left the sheep, they rushed off of that mountaintop, and they ran down to that little stable. A stable, something familiar to them. And yet instead of finding the cattle and the sheep alone, they found the perfect, spotless Lamb of God. And this morning you're here and you're saying, Pastor, I'm sick of comparing myself. I'm sick of trying to measure up. And I know I can't. But today I recognize that the good news is I don't have to measure up anymore. That I simply have to believe and call upon Jesus. Call upon him. And I'll have my name in the book of life. Call upon him and he will welcome me into his heavenly family. I don't have to fear death. I don't have to fear what others think about me because I can look into the eyes of Jesus and know that he loves me above all else. You're here this morning, you say, Pastor, that's me. I've never given my life to Jesus. I've never recognized that it's that simple. But today I want to do that. Today I want to ask him to come into my heart. I want to believe. And in believing that he'll accept me.
We believe.
Because he said so. If that's you, from the front to the back, the right and the left, if that's you, just slip up your hand and say, Pastor, would you pray with me this morning? I want to know that good news. I want to celebrate. I want that joy in my life as I celebrate Christmas. I want to ask Christ to come into my life. Just slip up your hand wherever you're at this morning. Yes, amen. Here in the front, anyone else? Jesus, come into my life today. Yes, amen. In the back. Hallelujah. I believe. I believe today. Accept him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.